Mr. Ernest has succeeded this year. He is preparing for a good harvest, even if he grows in an area heavily infested with Striga, a very harmful parasitic plant. Striga attaches itself to the roots of host plants such as rice and maize to parasitize. It sucks water and nutrients from the host plants and makes it ill. Striga produces so many small seeds that once turned and mixed into the soil, they can find new host plants to parasitize during the following season. But look at the crop of his neighbor Jean. Striga has done a lot of damage in his fields, and he knows he will not have a good harvest this year.
I have been growing upland rice on this field for 10 years, and every year my yields are getting lower. Striga is the cause of all my problems. Striga is really bad for rice and maize crops.
But what is the reason that Mr. Jean has such a bad harvest and Mr. Ernest such a good one? Let's listen to Ernest on the subject.
I have grown Nerica 4 rice variety in my field. This variety is more resistant to striga, weeds, drought and wind. I also use chemical fertilizers such as NPK and organic manure for a good yield. I have not plowed the soil at planting. I use cover crops like cowpea, mucuna and stylosanthus. These legumes reduce striga and also enrich the soil and develop a ground cover.
So, to have a good harvest despite the presence of striga, Mr. Ernest follows 4 principles. Number 1. Crop rotation or intercropping, including leguminous species. 2. Direct seeding in previous crop residues without soil tillage. 3. Fertilising the soil with chemical and organic fertilisers. And 4. The use of striga-resistant rice variety. Let's look at these principles in detail, one by one, to get a good understanding of this practice. The first principle is crop rotation or intercropping, including leguminous species. Rotation of rice with another crop is a good practice when confronted with striga. Let us listen to the reasoning of Mr. Ernest.
Before growing rice on this land, I grew maize, intercropped with cowpea and mucuna. So I practiced crop rotation. I cultivated maize because it is a food crop and it sells very well. I combined that with cowpea and mucuna to cover the soil during and after the season. This combination of crops enriches the soil and helps to manage weeds like striga. Mucuna is also a plant that repels certain insects.
So by using a combination of crops, one can protect and enrich the soil, better manage weeds like striga, and get good yields. To get good results, a number of species can be used as cover crops. But the best results are obtained with legume species such as cowpea, mucuna, rice bean, peanut, soya beans, crotalaria, or stylosanthes. As one of the main objectives of the intercrop is to cover the ground well during the season and after harvesting with crop residues, we must choose the species that produce a lot of biomass. But if a species does not produce a lot of biomass, but one still wishes to use it as an intercrop, it may be combined with another intercrop species. Let's listen to Madame Marriott.
I decided to combine maize, cowpea and mucuna. Cowpea does not produce enough biomass to cover the ground completely. So, I added mucuna. I grew mucuna 1 month after maize and cowpea because mucuna grows fast. The combination of maize and cowpea gives me a diversified food and also enriches the soil.
The choice of intercrops depends, of course, on the availability of seeds. Ask among your neighbours, colleagues and agricultural extension agents all the information on the advantages of different crops and seed availability in your village. To know what intercropped or combination of crops is best for you, you can test different options in your field. To summarise, if you have many problems with Striga in your rice crop, you can try a rotation with leguminous cover crops. You can grow them as intercrop with maize. It is important to assure that the cover crop species or intercrop combination chosen produces enough biomass to cover the soil with the crop residues during the season without crops. Vegetation or crop residue cover during and between seasons helps to shade the soil, which is unfavourable to Striga. In addition, leguminous plants enrich the soil with nitrogen, a nutrient that helps fight against Striga. And some species, such as groundnut and cowpea, also reduce the number of Striga seeds in the soil. Most importantly, to choose the cover crop species that is best suited to your field and its management, you will have to experiment with these different species. Now that we know the advantage of leguminous cover crops, let's look a little closer at the types of species of leguminous cover crops and their management. There are two types of legume species, annual and perennial. Annual species have short cycles, often comparable to that of rice or maize. These annuals are cowpea, rice, bean, mucuna, crotalaria and groundnut. The perennial species have long cycles that last more than one season. An example of such species is Stylosanthus. Annual species are fairly easy to manage as intercrop, but they do not always give a good soil cover because of the low rate of biomass or rapid decomposition after the season. Perennials, on the other hand, protect the soil very well during the period without other crops, but are often more difficult to manage. Let us listen to the experience of these two farmers, Mrs. Nirindra and Mr. Guy, on how to manage these cover crops in the field.
In November, I grow maize and cowpea, and in January, I harvest cowpea. Then I grow mucuna between the cowpea residues. During the cowpea harvest, I only harvest the pods and leave the rest in the field. When harvesting maize, I only collect the cobs. I cut the stems and leave them in the field with the mucuna.
I have a lot of experience in direct sowing without tillage and with soil cover, as it's a technique I have practiced for 7 years already. At first, it is imperative to till the soil. Then one must wait for the first rains before planting rice. After 25 to 30 days, we do the first weeding. Then we sow Stylosanthus between the lines of rice. When harvesting the rice, One collects just the panicles, leaving the shore in the field. The stylosanthes will continue to grow. The following year, one must roll the stylosanthes before growing maize. When the maize is ready to harvest, we only take the cobs, leaving the stalks in the field. And the following year, after rolling again, we can again sow rice. It is not necessary to plant stylosanthes every year. Simply do it once at the beginning of the first season when you start applying this practice. Then it grows every year.
The use of cover crops requires good management because if this is not the case, failure is guaranteed. It is not always easy because the rice needs enough space to grow well and cannot support too much competition with other crops. You must use a tool to cut and roll residues such as Mr. Guy's roller. You can ask blacksmiths in your village to make the proper tools. The alternative is to use a herbicide to kill strains of stylosanthes and any young weeds present. Stylosanthes will grow back later from leftover seeds. It is important to respect the time lapse required between herbicide application and sowing the next crop. Carefully read the label on the bottle of the herbicide product before use and follow the instructions. Above all, protect yourself well during the application of a herbicide, since they are toxic and can affect both your health, the environment, and your crops. The second principle is direct seeding in the previous crop residues without soil tillage. As we have understood, after a maize legume intercrop, the next season we can grow rice. Let's again look at Mr. Ernie's rice field, but this time at the time of planting. He sows in holes without ploughing the soil and without cleaning the field, so all the residues of the previous crop remained on the land. Let's ask Ernest what importance he gives to this practice.
I left all residues of previous crops in my field. It gives good soil cover and wind protection. This also preserves soil moisture. I can sow earlier in the season and have less weeds like cypress and striga.
So by practicing direct sowing, without tillage or removing the residues of previous crops, one can reduce striga infestation and thus obtain good yields. Direct seeding without tillage prevents the newly produced striga seeds from entering the soil where the roots are located, which denies striga the opportunity to attack crops. Then plant residues that cover the ground block the light needed to stimulate the emergence of striga. So to have good results, one must have enough crop residue, biomass, to cover the soil. To deal with the weeds, the soil must be more than 90% covered by these residues. The residues will slowly decompose and enrich the soil with nutrients and organic matter. This also improves soil fertility. The third principle is soil fertilisation with mineral and organic fertilisers. In addition to these good practices, Mrs. Mariette explains why and how she applies fertiliser to her crop.
I use NPK and organic manure for a good yield. The mineral fertiliser NPK is more expensive than manure. Manure comes free from my cattle. You only need to mix it with the rice straw, compost it, and bring it to the field.
So So mineral fertilisers and manure promote good growth of your crops. The best practice is to combine these two forms of fertiliser. The mineral fertiliser has the advantage of providing the necessary nutrients in a concentrated and balanced way. One can use compound fertilisers such as NPK or DAP, or a single fertiliser such as urea for nitrogen and TSP for phosphorus. Try to apply the equivalent of 60 kg of nitrogen and phosphorus per hectare. For example, when using NPK as shown here, which contains 11 parts nitrogen and 22 parts phosphorus and 10 parts potassium, apply 300 kg of NPK per hectare. This will result in 33 kg of nitrogen, 66 kg of phosphorus and 30 kg of potassium. Late in the season, you can add 60 kg of urea per hectare to complete the 27 kg of nitrogen missing at planting. If you need help, ask an agricultural extension agent to calculate the right quantities. One can reduce the application of mineral fertilisers when combined with manure or compost, like Mr. Ernest does in his field. The manure from your livestock has the advantage of being cheaper and puts organic matter into the soil. This organic matter contributes to soil fertility, soil conservation and moistening. Good soil fertilisation helps to reduce Striga problems. Striga grows mainly on soils that are low in nutrients like phosphorus and nitrogen. Raising the levels of these nutrients in the soil helps to reduce the number of Striga plants parasitising on your crops. But Mr. Ernest has another little secret to reveal to us to explain his very good yields. He uses a variety of rice that has resistance to Striga. The fourth and final principle is the use of a Striga-resistant rice variety. But how to choose a good rice variety? Listen to Ernest.
In addition to direct sowing, no tillage and the use of vegetative soil cover, I use improved rice varieties because they are resistant to diseases, weeds and insects. They also grow well. I use varieties such as Nerika. Those varieties are resistant to Striga. They are widely available.
It is true that some varieties are more resistant to Striga. They are less infected with Striga than other varieties. These Striga-resistant varieties are, for example, Nerika 2, 3, 4, 8 and 10. Varieties which are moderately resistant are Nerika 5, 9 and 17. But the effect of Striga may vary by location, so test these varieties in your fields and make your choice. To make sure these varieties stay resistant for a long time, their use should always be accompanied by other means to fight against Striga, such as fertiliser application, crop rotations or intercropping with leguminous crops, and if possible, the practice of direct seeding without tillage. In summary, there are at least four ways to fight against Striga in rice. Crop rotation or intercropping with leguminous species. Direct seeding in the previous crop residues without soil tillage. Soil fertilisation with mineral and organic fertilisers. And finally, the use of Striga-resistant rice variety. These good practices are not all easy, and you do not have to use them all. While all of these practices combined give the best results in the long term, you can already reduce Striga infestation with two or three of these combined practices. But it is important to understand that you should try out these different techniques yourself, experiment with them, and adjust them according to your local conditions. This can take time and create risks of partial losses at first, but the results of many of your colleagues are encouraging, so try it out.
Before, my rice yield was insufficient for the consumption of my whole family. Every year, I was obliged to buy additional rice. Since I practice these techniques of direct sowing without tillage, leaving crop residues on the soil, using a crop rotation with legume intercropping and growing nerica, my rice crop is largely sufficient.